Hello, this is a brief video about molecular evolution. It's the primer about the molecular evolution. So what is this molecular evolution all about? So you know, the evolution can be, the evolutionary studies can address broadly two kinds of objectives. The first one is about examining the process of evolution. What drives organic evolution? Organic evolution is nothing but biological evolution. So what drives it? There is a lot more theoretical aspect of the evolutionary biology, you know, like selection or drift, or how it works, and exactly is what the original species is all about, right? The process of evolution, what drives evolution, and understanding the mutation, gene flow. Gene flow means from one place to another, migration and immigration, you know, the flow of the gene pool, isn't it? Natural selection, all those things comes in that first ream of the molecular evolution. Second one is about the history of evolution in specific context. For example, the evolution of angiosperm. Or if you zoom in, you can see that the evolution of, like mango trees. You know, how did it evolve into? All those things you can check it out. So what has evolution done in past, and understanding how living organisms are related. You see that relatedness in biology is in only in one specific context, that is relatedness because of the shared ancestry, you know, not by looks alone, you see. So it's only about the inheritance, isn't it? So how the living organisms of the current day are related and how they have changed over time. So, you know, that is exactly how you are making a phylogenetic tree, right? To see the relationship between the living organisms and what we construe as the family of certain plant species, plant lineages. Are these families are accurate as per the phylogeny? So that is exactly, you know, the purpose of the phylogenetic tree, right? So that is what the history of evolution, history of specific lineages. Lineages is basically the, the branches of the phylogenetic tree, you know. So that is another way to check out the same pattern. Now, what exactly is evolution? Evolution is nothing but change in allele frequencies of a population over time. You can also call it as gene frequencies, the change in the gene frequencies or allele frequency. Allele is a better term because it means that the variants of the same gene, right? In diploid organisms, of course, you can have two kinds of gene. Everybody, you know, we all have two copies of the genes, right? Maternal and paternal chromosomes, isn't it? So what drives evolution? How this allele frequencies change, or gene frequencies change from one generation to another generation? Remember, it doesn't happen in one generation. In individual's lifetime, no evolution happened. You need at least one generation for the evolution to happen, you see. So how does it work? There are four processes driving the evolution. The first one is mutation. Mutation is completely a random process in which the stretch of DNA molecule can get the single nucleotide polymorphisms, isn't it? The point mutations, because of various reasons. The most prominent among them is, you might think, okay, it is basically because of the environmental factors like UV. No. The most prominent is the replication errors during the DNA replication, because DNA polymerase is an error-prone enzyme, you see. And the errors in the DNA polymerase is, in one sense, it is programmed in that way, isn't it? Because mutation is extremely important, because that is a driving force. The variants are the driving force for evolution to happen, adaptation to happen, selection to happen, isn't it? So that mutation is really important. Selection, of course, the selection is a de facto driving force of the organic evolution, isn't it? The natural selection or artificial selection, which we have already explained in the previous lectures of the same playlist, is that so it's basically preferential survival of certain variants which are well adapted to the environment. So because of this adaptation, they can survive to reproduce, to pass on their gene to the next generation. That exactly is what the natural selection is all about. And if there is a human mediation in the natural selection, for example, a cat breed or a dog breeds, or agriculture, the entire realm of the agriculture is plant breeding. That is called artificial selection. Then the third process is gene flow, the flow of the genes from one location to another, the gene pool, isn't it? The flow of certain genes because of the migration or immigration or emigration, isn't it? Immigration is going out, you know, emigration is going out, immigration is incoming, isn't it? So that is called gene flow. Of course, gene flow can completely change the genetic structure of a population, especially incoming, not really outgoing, but if some rare mutants are coming in to our population, that, and of course it mate with the population, then the population structure can change substantially over the time, isn't it? The immigration plays a crucial role, not really immigration though it is like double-edged, isn't it? Both happen simultaneously, isn't it? For one country to another country, if one person is immigrating, so it is basically for the receiving country it is immigration, while the sending country it is basically immigration, isn't it? So the fourth process is genetic drift. So usually genetic drift happens during population bottleneck situations. It's like normal neck of the bottle, when the population completely collapses because of the calamities, famine, for example, or dramatic collapse because of the asteroid impact, like Chihuahua, Chicxulub, the Yucatan Peninsula, that what really happened many millions of years back, isn't it? That is KT extinction event, I was referring to it. So that is, during those kind of calamities, when the population completely squeezes into a very few number of individuals, that who survive is just a matter of chance. Those individuals who happen to be in the cave might have survived, isn't it? So the climate change is also happening now. So who is going to survive? If it is a very slow process, then adaptation might play a role. But if it is super fast and extremely all pervasive force like an asteroid impact, then the persons who are surviving are surviving just because of the random chance, isn't it? So that is purely mathematical game. It's like a Russian roulette, isn't it? So that is what you call it as genetic drift. So drift plays a major role when the effective population size is very, very low. And when it is very high, the normal circumstances, genetic drift doesn't play much role. So, before coming into the molecular evolution, little bit a quick overview of the DNA. As we know, DNA is the predominant genome in most of the eukaryotes, isn't it? While few of prokaryotes do have the RNA. So it is a template for the synthesis of mRNA, tRNA, small interfering RNA, and rRNA, that is ribosomal RNA, isn't it? So if you look at the structure of the DNA, it is mainly, two kinds of nucleotides, isn't it? Nucleic acids, right, the bases. So purines and pyrimidines. So purines have two rings, while pyrimidine is just one ring. So pyrimidine is basically C and T are pyrimidine, just one ring, it is smaller, while purines are kind of bigger in size with two rings, adenine and guanine, isn't it? And the base pairing is complementary, AT with G, AT, then GC, that is the complementary base pairing. One with only two bonds, the other is with the three bonds, isn't it? So strand synthesis happens from 5', that is phosphate end, to the 3' end, that is OH end, isn't it? So the genetic code also, the structure of the triplet codon, so if you look at the codon, so that is basically each, of course, the triplet means three nucleotide code for one amino acid, right? The position number 1, 2, and 3. So each of these might code for different amino acids. So there comes phenomenon called degeneracy. That is the reason that so many are redundant. It codes for the same amino acid, despite these codons are different. So in theory, each codon can have four kinds of bases, A, T, G, or C, first position, second position, and third position, right? And then how many permutations is possible? It is permutation. Do you know why it is permutation? Because order matters. If order doesn't matter, it is combination. if the order matters. Why does order matter here? If it is in the reverse, then it will code for entirely different amino acid, isn't it? So order matters here, and the repetitions are allowed. You know, AAA is absolutely fine. It can code for an amino acid. You know, repetitions are allowed, and the order matters, and therefore it is permutation. The formula of permutation is NPR. Remember, we have learned that in a biostat module. So NPR is equal to N to the power R. So N to the power R here, N is 4, right? There are 4 kinds of positions that each of the triplet codon position can have states. So these 4 states means 4 amino acids, isn't it? 4 nucleotides, A, T, G, and C. So that is why number 4 comes here. And 3, because there are only 3 positions are there. So 4 to the power 3 is 64. So there are total 64 kinds of permutations are possible with repetitions allowed, and order matters, you know. So because order matters, of course, the permutation is always higher than combination. Had it been combination, it's much lesser, you know. So 4 to the power 3, 64. So out of which 3 are nonsense codon. Nonsense codon means stop codon. Whenever that codon comes, the replication just stops, you know, not the replication, but a transcription stops, isn't it? So that is what you call it as the stop codon or nonsense codon, while these are sense codon. 61 are sense codon. So degeneracy or redundancy of the genetic code means that many of these 61 sense codon code for the same amino acid. For example, UUU code for phenylalanine, so as UUC. Leucine is coded by UUA, so as UUG. You see, so that is exactly what degeneracy means here. And so how does this molecular evolution happen? I told you there are 4 main way. So mutation is one of the major, major force behind the molecular evolution. So mutation can happen either on the DNA or in the splicing mechanism. So splicing is basically nothing but, removal of the introns, right, from the native mRNA after the transcription state. So that, you know, that introns needs to be removed before processing. Those mechanisms can also have that splicing, spliceosomes and mutation can happen. That will also have impact. As we will see, these kind of mutations are being extensively used by viruses. Recombination is a driving force for the mutation. It could be horizontal gene transfer as well. Horizontal gene transfer means, it is actually lateral between entirely different lineages. For example, bacteria to eukaryotes, you know, or plant to animal, you know. So those kind of lateral gene transfer, plant to animal, are really uncommon. But among bacteria, completely unrelated genus and families, this kind of phenomenon are really, common. So that is called horizontal. So that is called lateral. So other one is called vertical gene transfer from parents to offspring. We all got it from our parents, right? The genome. So that is called vertical. That is a normal way. But horizontal is very interesting. And that do happen, especially in prokaryotes. And gene duplication is another mechanism of the molecular evolution, the duplication of gene, also known as paralogy. You know, all these are mechanisms of it. So by the way, open reading frame also plays a crucial role, because ORF, if there is an indel happening, then it will have a huge ramification on several of the genes involved in it, because there are open reading frames. You know, indel means insertion and deletion. So each strand has got 3 open reading frames, as you know, from 5' to 3' direction. 3 ORF, why 3? Reason is simple, the triplet codon, right? The codons are triplet. So 3, then 3, 3, 3, isn't it? So total there are 6 ORFs in a double-stranded DNA molecule. Because in each strand there are 3 ORF. It starts with the first codon, second codon, third codon. Then comes the second codon, so first codon, first position are same. So that is the reason that each direction there are only 3 open reading frames, you know. And Of course, because it is double-stranded DNA molecule, the second strand will also have three or off. So in total, there are six open reading frames, you know. So you can make use of it to have entirely different kinds of proteins, you know, amino acid sequence than proteins, based on which or off it is basically being read, you know. So another kind of mutation is point mutation, or also known as SNP, that is single nucleotide polymorphism. It's just substitution at one point, you know, from one base to another base, isn't it? So point mutation were in triplet codon, that has impact on the degeneracy, because the third position of any codon, it rarely causes change in amino acid. So amino acid changing mutations are called what? Non-synonymous mutation, right? And if amino acids are not changing even after the mutation, that is called synonymous mutation, right? Synonymous and non-synonymous. So the third position is highly degenerous. That is what it means, degeneracy, because third position rarely causes amino acid changes. Mostly it is synonymous, only 30%. How about the second position? Second position is always changes amino acids, so it is not degenerate at all. How about first position is also not that highly degenerate, because 96% cases it changes the amino acid. That means it is non-synonymous substitutions, you see. So mutations or substitutions could be synonymous, that means silent. That means that no change in amino acid, but non-synonymous or non-silent, that means changes the amino acid. So site within the codon, you know, so four-fold degenerate means any mutation are synonymous. Usually it is the third position is four-fold degenerate. And some sites in the codon are two-fold. Well, it depends on which one, right? For example, UUN, that is two-fold, because that N out of four different kinds of bases, it codes only for two amino acids. You know, so two code for the same amino acid, while other two code for the same amino acid. That is why it is called two-fold degenerate, right? And non-degenerate, certain positions are non-degenerate. I told you, usually the second position is usually non-degenerate. And also in certain triplet codons, the first position is also non-degenerate. For example, in this codon, N-U-U. So whatever be that N, you know, the out of four different kinds of substitutions, each one codes for a different amino acid, you know, so it alters amino acids. So it is not really synonymous. It is non-synonymous substitutions. So that is why it is called non-degenerous, you know, positions. You know, Hargobind Khurana, he is basically a Punjabi, isn't it? He was, his mother tongue was Punjabi, though he got his Nobel Prize in the US. And he is the one who discovered what the triplet codon, the genetic code, right? The cracking of the genetic code for which he got the Nobel Prize, right? He is from Punjab, you know, or university is also from Punjab, isn't it? So mutations can be of two types, transitions or transversions. So transition basically means replacement of purines with purines, you know, that means double ringed structure with double ringed structure, or pyrimidines with pyrimidine. That is single ring structure with single ring structure, right? So there are only four possible transition errors or transition substitutions are possible. A to G and vice versa, and C to T and vice versa, right? So it occurs quite often due to steric and chemical similarity. So steric means stereochemistry, right? How it looks like, and also the hydrophobicity or hydrophilicity. So these are quite similar. You know, so similar things getting replaced doesn't have much impact, but transversion is just opposite. Purines with pyrimidines and pyrimidines with purines, that is going to be having huge impact, you know, on the outcome. Usually it is non-synonymous, right? So there are eight possible transversion errors involved. A to C vice versa, A to T vice versa, G to C vice versa, and G to T vice versa, right? So if mutations, that is molecular evolution, occur randomly, transversion would have been two times more likely, because, you know, there are eight possible transversion errors. At the same time, for the transition, there are only four, possible transition errors, right? So 8 divided by 4 is 2. So 2 times more likely is a transversion. But in reality, transversions are really rare. The reason is simple, because the transversion result in non-synonymous substitutions. The amino acid changes. And because amino acid changes, the protein changes. And because protein changes, the baby will not even be born, you know. So stillbirth. So that is the reason that the transversions are not really passed on to the offspring. Even if it's passed on, the baby is born. Baby never reached the reproductive age to pass on the, that genome to the next generation. So that is the reason why transversions are really rare, while transitions are really common, you know. And majority of the observed transversions render new amino acid with similar chemical properties. For example, both are hydrophobic. In that case, secondary structure of the protein is not hampered. You know, if that is the case, then that such transversions do happen in the nature. But most of the cases, transversions are relative rarity. Transitions are quite common, you know. So transversions in the non-coding positions are also subjected to certain other constraints. As I told you, in the coding position, transversions are not at all tolerable unless the resulting amino acid is chemically or sterically similar to the one which is being replaced. But how about a non-coding, like introns, you know? So, of course, it doesn't happen. There are, because these non-coding sections also do play a crucial role in the functionality of the, you know, of the organisms. So long homopolymer stretches to avoid, you know, so the transversions, you know, that is going to have the constraint. So what is the problem with the long homopolymer? Homopolymer means the same amino acid, like same nucleotide, for example, A, 10 times A or 10 times T. So such homopolymer stretch, you know, so that is going to be trouble for the DNA polymerase. You know, they slaughter when it reads through the this kind of a polymer stretch. So if the transversion happens to form that kind of a homopolymer stretch, such transversions are not tolerated, you know, such because of the homopolymer stretches can result in open reading frame errors. Even for DNA sequencing, such homopolymer stretches are really tough, especially in the telomeres, you know. So that is the reason why human genome sequencing took such a long time, and even now it is completely unfinished. Because of this homopolymer, it's going to be a problem. And also conservation of the binding sites of the protein. Binding sites needs to be conserved, right? If the binding site, for example, transcription factor binding site is not conserved because of the transversion, then how the genes can express, isn't it? So transversion on the non-coding, when the TF binding site is a non-coding, can have impact on the expression of the gene, the epigenetics, isn't it? So yes, so indels are a lot more deleterious. Till now we were saying transition and transversion as a substitution, right? A point mutation. But indels are insertion or deletion that's going to have a huge ramification. The reason is that it's going to affect the entire open reading frame, after that particular indel is happening. But if there are three insertion or three deletion, then that particular problem is solved. The open reading frame errors will be solved, you see. So ORF will be conserved. And indels are rare in exons, but quite frequent in introns, because intron indels are a lot more tolerated than exon indels. And viruses do mediate these indels extensively to have many proteins possible with their small genome. So usually the viruses are so tiny, isn't it? Even the genome itself is so tiny, like coronavirus, SARS-CoV-2, genome size is very small. And how do they actually achieve, how do they get all these spike proteins and all those proteins expressed? Because they play with open reading frames. For double-stranded DNA viruses, you know, you can have 6 ORF, and each of these ORF, you can code for a different proteins. Too smart, isn't it? So yeah, so that is the beauty of the viruses, you know, they mediate these indels for getting lots of proteins from their very small genome size. So mutations in the spliceosomes usually lead to the destruction of the gene function. So spliceosome, I told you, it's a complex of the small nuclear RNA, that is snRNA, and the protein subunits that removes introns from the transcribe the pre-mRNA. So after transcription, the mRNA is formed, right? That is called pre-mRNA or hnRNA. So, you know, nuclear RNA. So this hnRNA is basically needs to be, the introns needs to be removed by the spliceosome, right? So that this process is generally referred to as a splicing. So if that protein with RNA complex, if they are not removing that introns, then introns also get expressed, which leads to dysfunctional proteins. Right. So, yeah. So, again, the viruses do mediate extensively on the spliceosome mutations to get things done. You know, very interesting, isn't it? And coming to recombination, that results in large number of variations. So, recombination happens in the diploid eukaryotes during meiosis. That is basically during the pachytene phase of the meiosis one. If you can review, how the meiosis happens between homologous chromosomes from biparental inheritance, isn't it? So this kind of chromosomes are getting mixed up, isn't it? Because of the crossover. So that is nothing but exchange of the genetic materials from homologous chromosomes, right? That result in the recombinant chromatids. So that recombination is a very important mechanism in which molecular evolution happen in the sexually reproducing organism, diploid organisms. Horizontal gene transfer is frequent in bacteria and viruses. So origin of eukaryotes from the prokaryote itself is due to the horizontal gene transfer. Remember, it is basically endosymbiotic theory, isn't it? Viridae plantae formed. That's horizontal gene transfer, you see. And also, all retroviral infections result in horizontal gene transfer to the host somatic cells, so vegetative cells. So whenever we get a common cold, rhinoviral infection, or any kind of retroviral infection, you see, HIV, for example, our genome changes. And even the human genome, if you look at the human genome, almost 40% of the human genome are nothing but relics of, relics of this past viral infections that our ancestors, forefathers and foremothers have suffered, thousands of years back, right? So, so you can see that the retroviral infections, they integrate their genome into our genome. So that is also an example of horizontal gene transfer. So gene duplication is another phenomenon in which the molecular evolution happened. It can involve single genes, that is called paralogy. Paralogous genes are genes that are a resultant of gene duplication event. For example, hemoglobin and myoglobin, So that is a paralogous gene because of the gene duplication. Genes are duplicated, Orthologous genes are not because of the gene duplication. It is because of the, these are the homologous genes separated by speciation events are known as orthologous genes. At the same time, paralogous genes are genes separated by gene duplication events, Now, entire chromosomes can also duplicate, isn't it? Aneuploidy, the term aneuploidy means entire chromosome gets duplicated. It's very common in eukaryotes. Of course, the chromosome comes in eukaryotes only, but again, even in human being, isn't it? Aneuploidy is pretty common, especially aneuploidy of 21, chromosome number 21. 18 and 13 are very common. 21 is trisomy 21, Down's syndrome. So that is, again, that is because of the aneuploidy, right? And entire genomes can also duplicate. That is also a kind of a gene duplication, isn't it? The entire set of genome duplicating, That is called polyploidy, very common in plants, And complex body plans of multicellular animals are made possible by the molecular evolution through gene duplication of homeobox genes. So that is basically paralogy, that single gene, Hox gene. Hox is nothing but homeobox, is a family of the genes which gets duplicated, and that is the reason for complex body plan. For example, we have we have a kidney on our right side and left side, testis, two testis. I mean, most of our organs, we have got two, right? It comes in pair. Eyes, we have two eyes, you know, because we are bilaterally symmetrical organs, isn't it? And how did that happen? Have you ever thought about it? So I have linked up a very interesting, review article from in the Nature about the Hox gene and few other genes which are involved with this bilateral symmetry and other complex body plans. Please check it out, right? So Hox gene, the paralogy, do plays key role in the evolution. And the population, polymorphisms are nothing but the variants of the same gene that is quite commonly found in the population. So, of course, we already knew that the evolution is nothing but change in allele frequency in a population over time, over generation, right? So polymorphism, you need to have polymorphism. It's a baby step towards evolution, isn't it? So mutations that are passed on to the offspring and coexist with the original gene is called polymorphism. So it needs to coexist with the original. While these are actually germline mutation, these are not somatic mutations, it will never result in polymorphism. It needs to be in the germline, you know, so that means reproductive, the cells which are involved in the reproduction, like gametes and sperm. So those will lead to the polymorphism, right? So different variants of a particular locus, that is basically the location in the genome, is known as allele. Allele is nothing but variants of the same gene, you know, in a biparental inheritance, isn't it? So alleles, the polymorphism means different kinds of allele, not same allele, but two different types of alleles, right? So a retroviral genome replication is highly error prone. So that is itself is a mechanism to increase the polymorphism. The retrovirus needs to escape from host immune system, right? They need to express different epitopes in its antigen presenting moiety, right? So in its for example the spike protein. So yes, the error prone replication itself is an adaptive trait for them to increase the polymorphism, isn't it? So HIV, for example, exists as a continuously changing swarm of genomic variants. So such things are known as quasi-species. It is not, it's kind of one species only. But if you carefully look, each species will have so much of the polymorphisms in it, you know. So that is what you call it as a quasi-species concept in HIV. So that is one reason why we still don't have HIV vaccine, you know. Or even the common cold, the vaccine, it's almost impossible to get a vaccine with the current scenario because it's keep on changing because of the evolution. Molecular evolution is quite faster because of the, the error prone replication machinery, you know. So diploid organisms carry two alleles at any particular locus, two because we are diploid, right? Die, one from mother, one from father, maternal, paternal. You know, and if both are identical, it's called homozygous at that loci, or if it is different, it's called heterozygous at that locus. You know, so in one locus, it could be either homozygous or heterozygous. So heterozygosity is exactly what you call it as polymorphism. That means alleles are different, right? So if you look in the DNA sequencer, the Sanger sequencer, electrophorogram, you can easily spot the heterozygosity. You will see simultaneous peaks, two equal peaks which are kind of similar in amplitude. You will see in same position in the sequence electrophorogram. See, have you seen electrophorograms? That is the output of the DNA sequencer. It's very simple. It's like this is the amplitudes, you know, like an ECG, isn't it? So each one in a different color. So because each one codes for a different amino acids. So it's very clear wherever this red peak is there, it is T. wherever there is a you know, this blue peak is there, it is C. All fine, everything is fine except this position. Is it an A because of a green peak, or is it a G because of the black peak? Wherever the black peak is there, it is G. So it is like both are here. Come on, how is it possible? The reason is that it is the same locus, same position. One chromosome is coding for A, another chromosome, is coding for another allele. See, basically the same, right? So another allele is coding for G. So that is why you have got two different kinds of genes for that locus. So that is what you call it as heterozygosity or polymorphism, isn't it? So that is what. Now, there's another term called fixation rate. What is that? Fixation. So evolution is change in allele frequencies of a population over time. So some of these alleles are lost, while some rare mutants get fixated. Fixated means its frequency became one. Frequency means probability. You can interchangeably use it. These are nothing but synonyms. So some alleles are lost over time. That means decrease the frequency or probability to zero. Completely lost, that kind of alleles. While some increase the frequency to one. 100%. That means every single individual of that population have that variant of that gene. So that is what one. So when the frequency became one, that means 100%, it you can call it as that allele has been fixated in the population, So rate at which this happened is known as fixation rate. And that is also known as substitution rate and mutation rate and evolution rate. The rate of molecular evolution is nothing but the rate at which one allele is being fixated in the population. So fixation means increase the frequency to one. That means every single individual get a copy of that allele. So rate of molecular evolution is substitutions per site per time unit. So how many substitutions in one site per, let us say, 1,000 years happens. So that is called the rate of molecular evolution. That is a unit of molecular evolution. Every phylogenetic tree, you will see the substitutions per site, per unit, per year or per 1,000 years, or per 1,000,000 years, if you're looking at higher taxonomical hierarchy. Successive fixation of the alleles, that is fixation of the mutations, that result in the long-term evolution of species. I think now you got an idea how about molecular evolution are happening. So molecular evolution happens through successive fixation of allele. One allele get fixated, that means frequency became one, then second, third, fourth, like that. Then that drives the process of evolution at the molecular level, if you look at the DNA sequence. So like this, as the years pass by, this particular, the circled allele, from 0.4, it increases to 0.8, then slowly decreasing up to zero. So when it becomes zero, the frequency becomes zero, that means that that allele is gone from the population. You see? So it's the time. Now, this particular allele, the square allele, it was a very rare millions of years back. And as years goes by, it is increasing in frequency and finally it is fixated. So the rate at which the fixation happens is called the rate of molecular evolution. So it's fixated means its frequency becomes one. What does that mean? One means 100%. Remember, in probability we learned, probability is always between 0 and 1. 0.5 probability means 50%, isn't it? So 1 means every single individual have that mutant, have that allele. So as this, this triangular allele, earlier it was 0. Then somewhere here it arised and the frequency became 1. And how, why this happening? Have you thought of it? For example, the circled allele initially increased, then decreased. Remember in earlier module, we have seen about the Kettlewell's moth in England. The frequency keep on changing. Earlier it was peppered, right? Then black, then again peppered came, isn't it? So frequency increased, then decreased, then increased. So this increased because this mutant had fitness advantage, selective advantage. Then it slowly decreasing because it lost a selective advantage in competition with other alleles. So because it is losing, other alleles are gaining. Because it's all game of who you know, survive to reproduce better, isn't it? That is what the idea of the natural selection of the Darwin, isn't it? So rate of molecular evolution depends on several factors, including generation time. So that means that, you know, the time required to pass the pass the genome to the next generation, that means to achieve the reproductive age, to mate, you know. So for human beings, it could be 15 years, isn't it? Or 10 years or 15 years, isn't it? But how about the generation time for bacteria? So it is only a matter of few minutes, 12 minutes for E. coli, isn't it? So that is why it's so much faster for prokaryotes. For viruses, it's much more faster, you know. Fitness of the organism carrying the polymorphism rate depends on the fitness of that organism. Population size, and genetic drift, reproductive potential of the organism, competition of the allele, everything. This is an interplay of various factors that contribute in the rate of molecular evolution. So fitness, we have already described in earlier module. It describes the individual reproductive success and is equal to the average contribution to the gene pool of the next generation that is made by average individual of the specified genotype or the phenotype. So the Darwinian fitness, that means it's genetic fitness, right? Comparing with the physical fitness. So it's not the physical fitness, right? The Darwinian fitness or biological fitness is, or evolutionary fitness is only about reproductive ability, you know? And inclusive fitness is yet another term. Again, we have introduced the term. It is about indirect reproduction because of the shared allele, the kin selection and group selection, right? So kin selection, because of the kinship, we have shared gene pool. For example, your own kin, like your sister or brother, you know, even if you are not reproducing, if you help them to reproduce, pass their genome to the next generation, then that is called inclusive fitness, right? So this fitness is, we have already introduced that absolute fitness and relative fitness, isn't it? Absolute fitness is a fecundity, how many offspring a particular individual have. Relative fitness is the absolute fitness upon the average fitness. So average fitness of the population as a whole. So if you take these two things together, so absolute over average is called, it is basically the relative fitness, you know. So that term, we have already seen that. So selective pressure means what? Fit alleles, the population will be subjected to positive selection, selective pressure. So positive selective pressure means that alleles, the frequency increases. Eventually, it gets fixed, you know. At the same time, non-fit alleles will be subjected to negative selective pressure. So negative selective pressure means the population try to get rid of such deleterious alleles because of the something called purifying selection. You know, deleterious alleles changes the amino acid because of the non-synonymous substitutions. Population try to get rid of it, right? So heterozygosity, that means polymorphism of both alleles at a loci, can be advantageous in certain situations. For example, that is called balancing selection. Heterozygote is more fit than homozygote. One example is, the hemoglobin S allele that result in something called sickle cell anemia, you know. So sickle cell anemia is a dangerous disease if it's homozygous, HBS, that means SS alleles are lethal, you know, it cannot survive. But an individual with HBS and HBA, that is AS, heterozygotes, they are better than AA. You know, AA is a wild type, right? Normal hemoglobin. AS is basically heterozygotes. Why are they more fit? Because they are resistant to get malaria. And that is the reason why, you know, this kind of heterozygosity, the S allele is being saved in the population in those locations where malaria is very common. For example, here in India or in Africa, right, where malarial disease can be found, you can see that S allele, even though S is deleterious, you know. So that is the reason it departs, of course, from the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Right? Any departure from the equilibrium is selection. And this is, of course, the balancing selection. Selection is playing a role here. So, you know, a quick review here. Few questions I'm going to ask you. Sickle cell disease is due to a point mutation. That is nothing but SNP, right? Substitution. A to T, adenine to thymine, of the beta globin gene, which result in glutamic acid being substituted at valine at position number 6. Is it transition or transversion? Is it synonymous or non-synonymous? Of course, it is non-synonymous, right? Because you're getting a different amino acid, isn't it? Glutamic acid with the valine. So it is non-synonymous. It is not a silent mutation. It's a non-silent mutation, isn't it? And now, is it transition or transversion? It is basically purine to pyrimidine, isn't it? A to T, A is a purine to pyrimidine. So it is basically a transversion is happening. So this is the transversion. Adenine to thymine is A to T, and T to A is basically transversion. I told you there are 8 transversion possibilities while only 4 transition error possibilities are there, right? So it's a transversion. Another question to you. Which among the following 4 evolutionary processes explains how defective allele HBS that causes sickle cell disease is maintained in human population? Positive selection, negative selection, purifying selection, and balancing selection. Yes, it's balancing selection, right? So balancing selection, as I explained to you, it refers to a number of selective processes by which multiple alleles, that means different versions of the same gene, are actively maintained in the population, that is, or the gene pool, at frequencies larger than expected from the genetic drift alone. Of course, you, because of the genetic drift, you will see some variants in the population, but more than that, you can see certain variants like HBS is being maintained. That is called balancing selection, you know. Examine 4 codons here. UUU, UUC, UUN, UUG. Third position of these codons are what? So, because first and second positions are all same, third positions can alter between 4 nucleotides, and each one codes for only 2 amino acids, isn't it? Resultant is either phenylalanine or leucine. So, third position is 2-fold degenerate, 3-fold degenerate, or 4-fold degenerate? Yes, the answer is 2-fold degenerate. Remember that 2-fold degenerate means only 2 amino acids is a possibility out of all types of mutation, 4 types of mutation, only 2 amino acids. Here, it's only 2 amino acids are resultant. So, what does 4-fold degenerate means? It's highly degenerate, right? So, that means that all mutations are synonymous, silent. How about, you know, 3-fold degenerate means only 3 kinds of amino acids possible out of it, right? So that is what a 3-fold degenerate. So it's basically 2-fold degenerate, only 2 possible amino acids being formed, right? So degeneracy is pretty low here. So 3-fold means it's highly degenerate. So usually degenerate means a chance of synonymous substitutions are high. That is what the degeneracy means. Thanks for watching.